it's my pleasure to address the DARIAH annual conference with this theme of interfaces. And thank you to the chair of the event, of course, Frank Fisher, the co-chairs, Francesca Morselli, Femi Admiral, and the other members of the program committee. And I was especially pleased to receive this invitation because quite literally, I'm obsessed with interfaces. And for me, interfaces are also synonymous with infrastructure. And so I'd like to acknowledge how important I believe the DARIAH network to be, with earnest appreciation of its board of directors led by the visionary Jennifer Edman, Tomasz Tuszkowak, and Frank Fisher, all of you who support its mission. I'm interested in interfaces because they act as a potential foil for what media theorists astutely describe as the logic of our era, database logic. This current age, it is said, created a paradigm of users who transform physical assets of cultural organizations into digital assets to be uploaded, downloaded, visualized, shared. Users who treat institutions not as storehouses of physical objects, but rather as data sets to be manipulated. In counterpoint, this presentation explores the ways in which mechanistic descriptions of database logic can be transformed, and computation can become experiential, spatial, and materialized, embedded and embodied in the everyday workings of museums. It was at the birth of the information age in the 1950s that the prominent designer Gyorgy Kepes at MIT said information abundance should be a landscape of the senses that organizes both perception and practice. This felt order, he said, should be a source of beauty, data transformed from its measured quantities and recreated as sensed forms exhibiting the properties of rhythm, harmony, and proportion. And the title of this speech, Computational Museology Interfaces to Cultural Big Data, is intended as a scaffold that unites machine intelligence with data curation, ontology with visualization, and communities of publics and practitioners with embodied participation through immersive and interactive interfaces. To set the stage for a new kind of museology, we could step back into the recent past when the CEO of Intel, former CEO, Brian Krasnick, declared in 2014, we're in the midst of a transformation from a world of screens and devices to a world of immersive experiences. But we know through art history, the history of science, and more recently media archaeology, that what he was really observing was hundreds of years of development in these prosthetic architectures of the senses. From the Kaiser panorama to the sensorama, the emergence of immersive environments coincided with the sublimation of curatorial praxis inside machines and represented the greatest challenge to the passive viewer since the invention of the roller coaster. For the last 20 years, I've been designing and building large-scale interactive frameworks for public engagement with cultural heritage, initially located at Museum Victoria in Melbourne, Australia, where I started to build these large systems and experiences. I then started to work with universities because I was very interested in how I could sustain this kind of infrastructure, high-end computer graphics with large hardware configurations for the GLAM sector. So that was my move to the university. I co-established the Applied Laboratory for Interactive Visualization and Embodiment at the Science Park in Hong Kong, and then returned to Australia to build the Expanded Perception and Interaction Center at UNSW. Here on the right-hand side of your screen, you'll see a small 7-meter diameter panorama. It's comprised of 56 projectors, it has a 29 computer cluster, and it's 120 million pixels in 3D. And at that scale, it's at the very edge of human visual acuity, and it was designed to solve visualization problems for complexity and big data in the humanities and the sciences. Now located at EPFL in a 1500 square meter warehouse, We've designed and built 12 large-scale systems that offer us strategies for multi-sensory engagement, emphasizing human-to-human as well as human-to-machine interaction, giving us powerful ways to reformulate narrative in a digital context. The Laboratory for Experimental Museology lies at the intersection of immersive visualization, visual analytics, digital aesthetics, and cultural big data. And we look at research from, as Frank said, scientific, artistic, and humanistic perspectives, and we promote a post-cinematic multi-sensory engagement using these experimental platforms. For many collecting organizations, among them the 95,000 museums worldwide, the ongoing global pandemic has starkly focused the use of digital as a mechanism for shared cultural futures. This presentation includes five themes, and they're mainly addressing different types of cultural data. And rather than a didactic presentation on design principles, human-computer interaction, or presence theory, I offer a variety of ways interfaces can intervene in different knowledge systems, encompassing the hemispheric, the panoramic, panoptic, and augmented ways of seeing and hearing. And I'll conclude this speech with a short introduction to my latest exhibition, Deepfakes, Art and Its Double, which explores futures for museums in a post-pandemic world. Traditionally, museums are ordering machines. They generate conventions of looking, institutionalized with the qualities of mechanized reason, similitude, homeostasis, and miniaturization. New interfaces, however, have unleashed the opportunity to reimagine these ways of seeing. The dome of the Prince of Wales Museum was adopted as the epicenter for an artistic exploration that specifically focuses on the architecture of Mumbai's heritage and contemporary buildings and transforms them into an urban celestial imaginary. Mumbai's architectural heritage is unrivaled in India. The city has one of the largest representations of grand neo-Gothic style architecture, numerous examples of Indo-Saracenic architecture, and of any city in the world, the largest number of Art Deco buildings. We shot 160 spherical gigapixels throughout the city. You're looking at the fisheye that's derived from that. That was the Baljulad Museum. This is Terminal 2, the new Mumbai airport. And the work allowed 2,000 people a day to come and rediscover their city with fresh eyes. The full dome was taken from Australia, and it was placed under the 60-foot dome at the Prince of Wales Museum. And open to all, it gave new perspectives on the many spaces that are socially exclusive despite their heritage status. And the work uses a simple computer vision algorithm that randomly selects any pair of images and creates a unique transition between them. So in effect, you could lie there all day and never see the same thing twice. The concept of an experiential domed environment emerged from attempts to stimulate the spherical gestalt of the human visual field and were designed specifically to exploit and extend sensory perception. In collaboration with the National Museum of Australia, we created two dome experiences, Travelling Kangkarangalpa, the songline of the Seven Sisters. This songline portrays one of the most defining meta-narratives in ancient mainland Australia, and it had never been told in the public domain before until this exhibition. It was 7 years in the making from the day that the Anangu elders came to the museum to help keep this songline alive. The first work involved photogrammetry of a sacred cave that had never been photographed before. Time-lapse photography, drone-based panoramas, gigapixel imaging, as well as ambisonics, allowing visitors intimate views of the stories contained within its sandstone folds. The digital dome was used in this project to simultaneously express the sphere of the world around us, not only the sky above, but also the ground below. Archaic dome theatres are typified by rock arcades found throughout Australia. And the theorist Nick Lambert argues that these ancient caves, the etchings and paintings animated by fire and torchlight, represent the beginnings of the cinematic imaginary and are arguably the first immersive experience of humankind. The second dome story immerses visitors in a series of projected artworks of the songline made by its custodians. And here we see these marvelous jumpy figures, their trussed grass figures, taking flight, pre-configuring their final destination in the night sky as the constellation Pleiades. These were collected by the National Museum. We made photogrammetric models and then worked with the Matu artists, where they created a range of specific depictions of each narrative as these as the Seven Sisters travel country. What was interesting about this process is the almost perfect mathematical fisheye distortion required for full dome projection was fully understood from the outset by these painters. It led to a complex set of interpretations to lead the narrative and resulted in a series of animated canopies of the story. This is a shot from the opening of the exhibition, and it won all the major awards in Australia and is now touring the world. What was really important was the length and complex gestation of 7 years, which finally resulted in a watershed of Indigenous and curatorial relationships in Australia. And what's also pivotal is that a research infrastructure grant enabled us to build the full dome for 5 museum partners across Australia and lend it to the museum for this exhibition. Once the exhibition was successful, the National Museum was then empowered to invest in their own full dome for the World Touring Show based on the designs of our laboratory. We journey now to the Dungguan Caves in the Gobi Desert of northernmost China. At the nexus of the Silk Road, this World Heritage Site has 492 caves dug into this cliff face. Inside, 45,000 square meters of mural paintings, 2,000 statues crafted by Buddhist monks over a period of 1,000 years. This sublime art treasury is like nothing else in the Chinese Buddhist world. Most of these caves are permanently closed to the public to ensure their preservation. And the digital is the only mode of visitation in an era characterized by heritage at risk. They're under serious threat from microclimate change and rising humidity. And an enormous preservation effort is underway there, mass digitization with over 60 full-time photographers. It takes 3 months to do camera array photography of a single cave. They also laser scan. In this work, the Pure Land projects activate the kinesthetic spatial responses of their viewers and give us important insights into how interfaces can operate in the museological domain. Here with Pure Land AR, we've printed the wireframe from the laser scan on the walls of an exhibition booth at 1-to-1 scale, and visitors are walking inside a digital model using this tablet as an interface on the world, like a window on the world. This was originally conceived for Art Basel in Hong Kong. What's interesting about it is the way that it harnesses socialization around a single screen. This is really at the core of the museological experience. It's not necessarily about giving everybody their own device, it's how we harness that, how we give multi-generational experiences out of the same interface, grandmother, grandchild, grandmother abandons the grandchild. Its third most noteworthy quality is that of virtual tourism. Here, the wife takes an iPad from her handbag and she films her husband's experience as if they were really there. It was reformed as an interactive experience for a full dome at the World Economic Forum. And theorists, of course, have long described how visual media have embraced the prospect of vision as unlimited travel. And we see in the human machine interface efforts towards the structuring of systems that serve cognitive processes, but also enactive learning. The cave was also reformed in 360 3D. Indeed, a single data set created five completely different modalities of experience, and these have been seen by over a million people worldwide. It's this malleability of digital data that is its intrinsic quality. And in its omnidirectional manifestation here, with its constantly varying angles and coordinates, the organization of space is one where gaze loses its privileged directionality, a democratic undertaking where there is no ideal eye, no framed or perfect composition, because the entire screen is rendered, captured, and on view. Interfaces can often embrace the spatial formats of their originating media. The Amaki Navigator enables visitors a spatial temporal form of navigation. The Amaki Navigator was designed for three hand scrolls entitled The Poetry Contest of the 12 Animals and completed this week for a new exhibition at Museum Rietberg in Zurich in the exhibition Love Fight Feast. From a physically embodied point of view, viewers reveal each of the 17th century hand scrolls along their entire length at one-to-one scale. Each scroll is approximately 12 meters long, as is the navigation system itself. So it's a horizontal narration system responding to viewers' interests, and the dynamic touchscreen travels along a motorized railing traversing the full length of each Amaki. The scrolls are unfolded in the original reading direction from right to left, while visitors can also jump to points of interest and between individual scrolls. The ultra-high resolution imaging of the scrolls completed by their custodians, the Chester Beatty Library in Dublin, enables zooming into details that are usually too small for the naked eye to see, providing unparalleled intimacy with the materiality of each, their papers and pigments, the subtle golds and silvers. Audio compositions are dynamic and they emerge from visitors' interactions and add narrative drama as the animals engage in a poetry competition or embark into battle. As a pan-aesthetic experience, it emulates the reading of traditional hand scrolls while also transforming visitor involvement in an interactive and non-linear narrative-enabling interface. And as simple as it is, it also requires a fundamental shift from linear to non-linear temporal and spatial folds, intrinsic only to the digital form and the concepts of expanded cinema. Inside Out entices the viewer into new modalities of multi-sensory engagement. Placing on a head-mounted display and turning a chair rotates the viewer inside panoramic scenes, which offer conjunctions of photographs from anthropic scenes of Angkor in Cambodia to the interiors of a Sydney paint factory that had been ravaged by fire. The visitor controls these changes of scene using a tongue-operated switch, which becomes this highly sensitive tool for navigation and exploration. The switch, which is a photographer's switch, when you're hanging off a cliff and you need to take the photo, you use one of these. Sheathed in a miniature condom for hygiene reasons, you put the tongue switch into your mouth and you use this as the navigation tool. And with your tongue, you run over these ruinous textures, and the tongue becomes the visceral point of touch that can only imagine what kind of nasty, sharp things you might lick up against. Even before database logic pervaded our thinking, the museum was marked by profound shifts in understanding of the archive. In modernity, the archive was first described as a product of bureaucracy designed as an instrument of power and knowledge, as we know from Foucault in 1969. In Archive Fever, Jacques Derrida, was 1996, described how mechanization and digitization was creating instant access to databases employing efficient dendritic classification and retrieval, in many cases, we are still in this mode. But we could describe new modes of archival access based on the properties of recollection, regeneration, and reworking, or remediation by Bolter and Gunson, if you like. They are dynamic and they correspond to a shift from classification to remix, a paradigmatic shift from the orthodox models of stewardship to one of co-production. Now, we know at most museums, there's only a fraction of the collection on display, and most of the treasures are hidden from view. At the Smithsonian, it's only 2%, British Museum, 0.4%. At Museum Victoria, 16 million objects, they only display 0.8% of their collection. So we created Museum Victoria, a massive data browser for their 360 3D system. It's an export from the content management system, so 100,000 objects, 25 fields of metadata, and it took 15 minutes to assemble the materials to do it like this. It's really a new paradigm for opening up the museum storehouse and a shared playground for exchange and interaction. You can zoom into the images, it creates a visual from the description. You can access the original record. Perhaps most importantly, it connects 18 themes across social history, indigenous material, and natural sciences using these metadata relationships. The material is temporally distributed, and you can travel in the Z-axis as far as the eye can see. And so it's an interface that doesn't have a search function, a text search function. And it really operates like a real-time curating machine where you'll always be presented with the unexpected. Now, when it comes to audiovisual archives, we know that they are the major records of the 20th and 21st century. Their sheer size and temporal nature present custodians with significant challenges to access and meaningful engagement with these vast archives, which have been invested in, are of primary concern. Jazz Luminaries is a work based on the constellation of jazz greats from EPFL's seminal UNESCO Memory of the World Montreux Jazz Digitization Project, the archive. The installation cuts, remixes, and replays 5,400 artists and 13,000 videos from a total archive of 11,000 hours of video. The neural net-like image that you see here is based on the social network of these artists, and the clustering is based, or the link strength is based, on the number of times that one artist played with another artist. And so you'll find that B.B. King lies at the very center of this world. Visitors lie under the dome and they use a spherical interface to navigate this constellation, emulating the hemisphere of the full dome in which it's staged. The search paradigm is akin to tuning a radio, search by listening, and it circumvents a lack of public knowledge into who actually the jazz greats really are. Hearing what you like drives the design to unfold in three layers, from a sample, all songs, to a full song. Right. So in that vein, we just received a large-scale grant, Narratives from the Long Tail, which is about transforming access to 120,000 hours of video from major collections. And it uses extensive computational resources and exemplar data sets to look at a triangulation across archival semantics, which allow everything in terms of machine learning and visual analytic processes to operate a corpus film segment, interfilm, and intra-image level, a kind of operationalization of the data, and narrative visualization. So this is trying to create narrative coherence in these vast data sets using experimental schemas, not only spatial, temporal, but social, affective, and aesthetic. And then experimental museology is the scalable public-facing interfaces for these audiovisual archives, advancing frameworks for participatory interaction. So that project has just started and it will run over the next 4 years. It's a Swiss National Funds grant. Right. Deep mapping. So the theoretical frameworks for the next section lie in deep mapping or cartocriticism. As defined by Rob Kitchen, we know an emphasis on absolute Euclidean space coordinates frustrates the humanist desire or effort to understand how spaces change over time and how spatial relativities emerge and develop into narratives. We need to reconceive our interpretations of the map as moving, embodied, social, technical, and emotive, and as an opportunity to present alternative visual solutions to depicting the specific problems of describing place and time. Conceiving maps through a deep mapping schema posits them as never fully formed, never static, but emerging in navigational processes where everything is on the move. The Atlas of Maritime Buddhism is based on a compelling story of the spread of Buddhism from India through the seaports of Southeast Asia and the South China Sea, supported by archaeological and historical evidence that's never been brought together before. This research and its exhibition series has profound contemporary relevance to the socioeconomic and political transformation of the world under the government, Chinese government-led initiative known as One Belt, One Road. And while this far-reaching enterprise of today reactivates ancient overland and maritime trading routes, the Atlas counterbalances prevailing narratives, which neglect the importance of Pan-Asian maritime countries and Buddhist entrepreneurship in the expansion of trade from the 2nd century BCE to the 14th century CE. It's a quite complex story, and I'm only going to be able to touch on it briefly. The spread of Buddhist doctrines came from India to China and triggered a profusion of cross-cultural exchanges that had a profound impact on Asian and world history. It involved multiple societies, diverse groups of people, including missionaries, itinerant traders, artisans, and medical professionals. Buddhism was spread by sailors who took with them Buddhist talisman. Intrepid monks from China and present-day Indonesia played a key role in the exchange from ancient China to India. Monks introduced from ancient India into China. Monks introduced new texts and doctrines to the Chinese clergy, carried and distributed Buddhist paraphernalia for the performance of rituals and ceremonies, and provided very detailed accounts of their journeys to India, sometimes up to 30 years long. So our project, which has been running over the last 6 years, has involved extensive documentation, thus far over 7 countries. Hundreds and hundreds of sites have been captured in 360 degree, 3D, and so on, and in this large scale imaging process. We're shooting on this camera, which is interesting because it's analog, but it gives us an infinitely high drum scan output as a stereographic panorama. But we use a range of off-the-shelf tools for a small team and both digital and analog data capture sources. And of course, ambisonics for a 3D architecture of sound. This is the Shwagodong Pagoda, the most revered site in Myanmar, which typically fuses the historical and the mythological. the far-flung first to third century stupa at Sarnati with its elaborate sculptural panels depicted by King Ashoka, who transformed India with the written word, the great Buddhist universities at Nalanda in Bihar, for example, which flourished in the fifth century, at Anuradhapura in Sri Lanka, these monolithic brick structures, mist encapsulated Borobudur, monsoonal Ayutthaya in Thailand. And photogrammetry was also a vital component. Here we see Jayavarman VII from Angkor at the National Museum in Cambodia. And many of these Buddha and Bodhisattva sculptures have never ever been seen or have never traveled outside of their country of origin before now. And the work, the field work for this section is completed. And we have a permanent exhibition in Taiwan and a temporary exhibition in Hong Kong and a world touring show in development. And both of these exhibitions include a whole range of new media types and interfaces. I'm only able to share one with you today. They also include seminal sculptures from collections both in Taiwan and in Hong Kong. Just a few shots from one of these exhibitions with these different modalities of engagement. And I'll look at this particular work. It's a panoptic interface. And by rotating the human scale wing, just in circumambulation, generates a dynamic temporal sequence one by one. The reverse rotation of the platform, meanwhile, reveals unexpected materialities. Icons melt, fragment, and refold in a series of computer graphic transformations and parametric visualizations. The acoustic realm of these sculptures is augmented with rare ethnographic archival recordings. The two truths in Buddhism are the truths of the mundane and the absolute. The sculpture itself has a double truth, if you like, both now and for frontality and multiplicity. The archaeology of the body is the subject of the next section, and it examines intangible cultural heritage and its processes of digital documentation, reproduction, and transmission in museological contexts. Most of you will be familiar with the tenets of intangible cultural heritage. This archive we've been working on since the masters came to us in 2012. We know that this is in Hong Kong. Hong Kong is an incredible reservoir of ICH and primarily of the Hakka people. And from mid to 20th century, Hong Kong provided refuge for teeming thousands of immigrants from mainland China. And amongst them were some of the most important martial artists in the world. With globalization, urbanization, and dwindling numbers of practitioners, this living heritage made internationally so famous by Jackie Chan, Gordon Liu, and Hong Kong cinema is now in danger of becoming lost. So the Living Archive is a 4D typology. It's based on extensive motion capture, a host of green screen and video techniques. We've done 130 empty hand and weapon sequences, 19 styles with 33 elite practitioners, edging up on 60% of the total repertoire of Taolu. This is Oscar. Both his father and great-grandfather were Kung Fu masters. You can see how fast and precise it is. Using motion data, of course, one can immediately create motion over time, signatures, left hand, right hand, left foot, right foot, and the Dantian point in the center of the body. We've had 9 exhibitions worldwide of this material, and it continues to grow. The Hong Kong government are now looking at building a museum and archival center for the digital archive, which is owned by the masters. One of the systems is this rear projected stereographic system that allows participants to walk around and look in at one-to-one scale the motion data that's kept inside. It's an interactive application, and it's reinterpreted here as a series of motion over time analysis. It's in 3D. This is the interface close up. This is an analysis of speed on the body at any given moment. And the theorist Brian Rotman uses this corporeal gestural haptic writing as a framework for recognizing motion capture as a continuous topological model that allows for the easier retainment of the affective qualities of movement. The difference between capture and notation is important. Instead of translating movement into symbols, as is done when speech is transposed into writing, gestural haptic writing is a mediation technology that states clearly signifying by operating within the interactive in a motion. The performance theorist Diana Taylor very early on positioned the archive as a resource that possesses knowledge transfer capabilities. And these are expanded with and by the repertoire, where the true source of knowledge is always the body. She says, performed and performed anyway, record and transmit knowledge. These museological features are needed to support knowledge transfer among novices. And we're getting there. This one is Unmakeable Love. It's really looking at new performative systems. It's based on a Samuel Beckett piece of prose called The Lost Ones, originally created in 2009. We're currently remaking it for a new exhibition at the ZKM in Karlsruhe. This artwork is a revisioning of Beckett's initial investigation that focuses and makes interactively tangible the state of confrontation and interpolation between ourselves and another society that is operating in a severe state of physical and psychological entropy. The interactive theater advances the practices of algorithmic agency, artificial life, virtual communities, HCI, augmented virtuality, mixed reality, and multimedia performance. The ensemble of technologies as strategies designed to activate what Gabriel Schwab calls the body's primordial inscriptions. The Lost Ones, like the works of Kafka, create a fictional and somewhat fantastic circumstance of constraint and deprivation. It describes a community of 200 people who are incarcerated inside a confined space and the resulting existential tension of these inhabitants' lives. Minutely constructed according to geometrical shapes and measurements, The Lost Ones is populated by an abject and languishing people whose culture seems to be organized according to an elusive order, if not an unfamiliar harmony, the principles of which have yet to be discovered. And because of the scientific exactitude of Beckett's text, we were able to write a schema that represents it as a high-level architecture. And then the script was written to animate all of the characters according to the principles, parameters, events, and actions found in the text. Each one of these parameters can be manipulated. The amplitude and frequency of events can be tweaked all at a software level. It's a kind of boundless choreography. We captured 350 motion capture sequences of five actors. And these are all strung together on the fly within the game's engine. The work is staged in this panoptic system that you saw before, rear projected stereographic, and it uses six interactive torches. Unmakeable Love's mixed reality strategies of embodied simulation intricately engage the presence and agency of the viewers and impel them to experience the anomalies of a perceptual disequilibrium that directly implicates them in this alienated and claustrophobic situation. Beckett's prose was interpreted by a number of leading scholars. Lyotard in The Inhuman speaks of its systematic madness. Porosh, who describes Beckett's cybernetic machine, and Schwab again, who interprets The Lost Ones as a kind of soul-making and envisions the text's narrative as a disembodied artificial intelligence exploring the boundaries between human and post-human. The only light that's cast in the world is coming from the participants' torchlights, and this explicitly articulates the conjunction between real and virtual spaces. If your torch beam hits the other side of the system, you're able to see through the screen and see the person that's standing there. It's a mixed reality system, and it's using infrared cameras which are mounted in front of each of the screens. The interactivity offered by Unmakeable Love is both theatrical and digital, and the six physical searchlights allow viewers to individually illuminate and explore the virtual scene, and the intersections create this dramaturgical aesthetic. The absorbed lost ones follow Beckett's algorithmic prescription, and they're oblivious to the torch users. And so, it's really that Unmakeable Love another that confronts the fear of the world, if you express the feeling that they are supposed to be able to express the feeling of a range of spectrums, interpersonal terrorism, refugee mentality, environmental performance, endemic incarceration. So, Unmakeable Love's forever automated post human universe. And now, on a much lighter note, and by way of conclusion, the exhibition Deep Fake Art and Its Double, which commences next week at the EPFL pavilions. So, this is a complex that I'm directing at the EPFL. And the exhibition will take up two of its pavilions. It's an art science or an amplifier for art science and society. And in participation with diverse communities, we're really working on experimental curatorship, contemporary aesthetics with open science, digital humanism, and emerging technologies. And because the exhibition is not yet complete for photography, this is the digital model that I will show you here. And deepfakes art and its double poses crucial questions about the potency of digital replicas to absorb audiences in enduring emotional encounters with universal art treasures. The exhibition opposes the use of deepfakes for manipulation and misinformation to explore very different perspectives, reimagining objects through advanced computational techniques. Decades of computer science and engineering have revolutionized the tenets of verisimilitude and representation. Today's perfect pixels coalesce in imaging techniques designed to replicate cultural artifacts with ultimate fidelity. They are exposing the optical unconscious of art, simultaneously as algorithms and computer vision re-perform and reprocess the digitally visible. They're exposing the optical unconscious of art, calling us once again to re-examine objecthood itself. Remediated through participatory interfaces, mixed, augmented, and virtual realities, deepfakes art and its double creates new performative platforms for the complex archetypes that emerge out of computational practices as they intersect with art heritage. The 21 installations are equally focused on affirming and activating visitors' sensory experiences while also grappling with the critical implications of digital materialities that objects possess in post-original form. We know that cultural deepfakes have manifold significance, technologically empowered to offer forensic insights into invisible dimensions, generating unforeseen hypotheses and connections. These art science phenomena also generate or propagate powerful auras which rise to the surface entangled with the affective qualities of the originating sources. Such augmented replicas are able to draw us into unparalleled tactility with the textures, patinas, and geometries of their counterparts. And with its propensity for peripheral vision, machine learning has amplified the possible futures for curatorial and artistic practices, antagonizing outdated notions of authority, authenticity, and access. These practices are generating perpetually new archival forms that are concurrently formed and formless. Digital facsimiles also decolonize matter as they defy hegemonic narratives, helping to liberate things from their colonial entrapments, confronting authoritative discourses, historical sedimentation, and contested social relations. In cases of heritage at risk due to warfare, iconoclasm, climate change, digital copies have enabled communities to become more resilient to loss. They can also act as or provide reservoirs of cultural memory and instruments for those on the margins to speak back to their oppressors. While vital issues for cultural deepfakes now include encryption of digital counterparts and places of the originals, we see an exploding of systems and codes of ownership, custodianship, and even repatriation. Meanwhile, the accumulation and exploitation of digital patrimonial and cultural capital by technological elites unnervingly reenacts colonial constructs. Synchronously, new forms of cryptographic control, such as non-fungible tokens, are being enabled for the network circulation of art, promoting the blockchain as a potential dominion of arbitrary value is a hallmark of the intensification of late capitalism's newest investment for its enmeshed cultural objects rather than their deappropriation into the commons. Deepfakes, art in its double, is a cumulative narrative that embarks on these cross-cutting themes, traversing the simulacrum, mirror worlds, digital twins, cryptocurrency, machine intelligence, while dealing with traditional issues of mimesis, reenactment, memory, and decolonization. The exhibition's installations cycle us through some of the antithesis around around which the history of art has been circumscribed. And as postmodernism recedes, taking with it the assumed meaning of things, cultural deepfakes have become a central pivot of this dialectic. Recognizing the importance of cultural deepfakes opens the way to redefine the dominant cultural technologic of our contemporary era. Thank you very much.